time now for the award-winning number one local talk show in Northeast Pennsylvania, The Sam Lesante Show. Now here's your host, Sam Lesante.
Well, folks, the book is called Life After Russian Roulette, Game Over. What's it about? Well, for those of you who have suffered from depression, maybe sometimes you want to commit suicide, let me tell you about the book itself. The book takes place in Baltimore, and it's based on a true story about a person who's been a police officer. And he was an undercover detective in drug groups and organized crime association. It begins with his life in uniform in Baltimore. It's also about his work after the police years, working for the defense lawyers that he worked against. And when he finally got licensed as a private investigator. Then the story takes him into the seminary. It ends with his life with the only woman he ever loved named Sharon, who died. It's an interesting story, folks. It's about a retired police officer. He is now now a minister. His name is Michael Kaminski, and he's on the show today. Michael, thanks for coming on the show.
Thank you, Sam. Thank you.
The book is very, very fascinating, and the thing is, it's a true story, okay?
It is.
So let's talk about, you know, give us your life. Give us a little background, you know, how you started, what you did, and where you ended up, and then we'll get into specifics here.
Only beginning with the police department, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Well, it was fascinating because you were in the service, right?
I was, yeah. My first job was in the Air Force, which took me to Southeast Asia and Vietnam. Mm-hmm. And when I came back, I worked actually for the Bureau of Customs for a while in Washington as a graphic artist. I hated it. I hated Washington. I hated graphic art. And so actually I resigned from the Bureau of Customs and went to work at a gas station, pumping gas, which didn't write my first wife up a whole lot. And then eventually I joined the Baltimore City Police Department because in those days it was a secure future, you know, and I was looking at a job that I could just keep for a long time and retire as a police officer. So I joined the Baltimore City Police. It was a fascinating, I was transferred, I was assigned to Western District right out of the academy. Western District is like the French Foreign Legion of Baltimore City. If you mess up, you go to Western District. I was, I guess, lucky enough to be transferred there right out of the academy. And Western was a place where you learned how not to be a police officer. You could get away with just about anything in Western District in Baltimore.
What year was this?
73.
73, okay.
73. By 74, the Baltimore City strike came up. Baltimore City Police Department went on strike. And we probably made history because police departments don't go on strike. We did. And when the strike was over, I left and went to work for Anne Arundel County Police, which is where I grew up. And I was in patrol for about a year and a half in Anne Arundel County, and they transferred me into vice and narcotics, into organized crime. And I was undercover for about 3.5 years. And that's probably the basis of the book.
So let's go back to, you were assigned to vice, right? Mm-hmm. Organized crime. So what happened there? This is where things start getting a little interesting.
After a while, you
became an undercover cop.
Yes, as soon as I was transferred.
Okay.
And I worked with my partner PJ, who is in the book, for a while, and then I went on my own. And primarily, what I was assigned to was I was assigned to either Naval Intelligence, Coast Guard Intelligence, the FBI, or the DEA. And it was a very psychologically disastrous life. I would never recommend this to anybody. I wouldn't do this again if I had to. But some of the investigations that I worked on was with a motorcycle gang called the Pagans. I was with the Pagans. I don't know if anybody knows about the Pagans, but they're not nice people. And I was with the Pagans for about 10 months. That investigation ended when they beat me up. They thought I was an informant. I was quality control person for a black drug ring. And I tested the cocaine shipments coming through, and if it was good, it would go on to the next level, probably going into high schools and middle schools. I had a business associate who had a used car lot and a chop shop in Baltimore City. He was one of my business associates. And if you did anything wrong, if you violated any of the rules with him, you were compacted in a car, you were crushed. Worked on a Coast Guard yard, docks for months. The interesting part about what I did was I was always by myself, and I really didn't care about life because I didn't care about my life. And part of the book is about my addiction and my depression and my desire to end my life, suicide. I named it Life After Russian Roulette because every day was like playing Russian roulette with a psychological Russian roulette. I wanted to die. I hated what I was doing. I hated the police department. I didn't like police. I didn't like myself. And it was like getting up in the morning and early forms of network marketing, who are you going to buy from and who are you going to meet? And it depended on who you talked to. And just I was in business for myself. You know, I was buying and selling machine guns. A very, very psychologically destructive a profession that we got into. And if you did it right, it destroyed you. And it almost destroyed me because I really did not want to live. You know, I used to go to, I grew up Roman Catholic, I'm a Protestant minister now, but I grew up Roman Catholic, and I used to go into an old church in Baltimore called St. Rose of Lima Church. And in the middle of the night, back in the days when the doors were still open, you know, they never locked the doors back those days. And I would just go to sleep on a pew and just ask God to get me out of this. I prayed for somebody to kill me, actually. I just wanted to, but I couldn't get out of what I was doing. I was probably so good at what I was doing that I just kept on going from investigation to investigation to investigation, and I couldn't get out of it, you know, until I finally set myself up for professional suicide. But the book is not only about what I did as a police officer, but what I did but why I did what I did, you know. The more that I did within the investigations, the more I hated life, and the more that I hated life, the more I drank. And I think people can relate to that way of life. It might not be their story, but it's my story, and I think they can relate to the connection between depression and suicide and hating yourself so much that you want to die and numbing it with alcohol.
Now, when did you start your addictions?
My addiction?
Yeah. When did you start the drinking?
In the 11th grade in high school.
Is that right?
Mm-hmm. I was drunk probably for like 23 years.
You were drinking from morning till night?
Mm-hmm. Not so much in high school, mm-hmm. but when I went into the military, Southeast Asia was really great for alcohol. You mm-hmm. know, it got you through the day. And even when I was with the Bureau of Customs, I was drunk all the time in Washington. I was drunk almost every day as a cop in uniform. And when I was transferred into organized crime,
your job at all, being drunk all the time?
Only to the point that it made me better at doing what I was doing.
Is that right?
Yeah. I felt like Teflon back in those days because the more that I drank, the less I cared about life.
Your family, mm-hmm. okay, any brothers or sisters?
I'm an only child.
Okay. Your parents still living?
No, they're both gone. Okay.
And when you grew up, how was your family life?
I was an only child, but I grew up in Baltimore. My dad is from Shamokin. My mom's from Trevernon. I was born in Baltimore because my dad came out of the World War II in Baltimore, and that's where I was born. Family life growing up, drinking was a way of life. Had some really good parties as a child that I can remember, being a Polish and Italian. Me, personally, I was a fat, dumpy little kid who had no self-esteem, who couldn't talk to girls, who couldn't dance. In fact, I me and three other guys started a rock band in our senior year in high school because we just wanted to watch the girls dance, and we couldn't dance. So, and we were all drunk, so we just played music and watched the girls dance. That broke up when we went into the military during Vietnam. But if somebody would have told me, Sam, that I was going to do this when I was older, I would have smiled at them, because being a very introverted type person, shy, fat, like I said, no self-esteem. If somebody would have said, you're going into organized crime and drug groups and you're going to do all that stuff, I would have said, you're probably nuts. But yeah, even after you started talking about my alcoholism, even after I left the police department and I started a private investigative agency, I had to, internal investigation caught up to me. And they gave me a choice. They said, you can either resign now and not say anything, not write that book, and go on your way, and we won't charge you with anything that that you had been doing. So I agreed not to write the book until years later. But after I left the police department, I started actually a private investigative agency, and I worked with the criminal defense attorneys, the organized crime attorneys that I worked against when I was a cop. And I did that for like 5 years. I prepared witnesses to testify against the government. And that was really another phase of my psychological destruction. I had no friends on either side. And that's part of the book. Part of the book that I write about is friends and enemies are interchangeable. It depends on what you're doing.
It's interesting. Folks, I'm talking to Mike Kaminski. Michael Kaminski, you can get the book on Amazon. It's based on a true story, Life After Russian Roulette, Game Over. We come back, we'll learn a little bit more where the fact he actually wanted to take his life. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Sam Lesante Show. Folks, remember 24/7 sspTV.com. Every one of our programs that we produce are available to you to see anywhere in the world. My email, sam@sspTV.com. My guest today, the author of Life After Russian Roulette, Game Over, Michael Kaminski. He says, I believe everyone has a dark side within their being, whether they want to acknowledge it or admit it. There are two faces that people see when they look at the person they think they know in relationships. Each one of us lives with a secret or hidden part of our personality in which we struggle to understand and want to conceal from other people. What do you mean by that?
For years, Sam, doing what I was doing back there in those years as a police officer, I had three different lives. Three different driver's licenses from three different states, three different Social Security card numbers. I was three different people. And I believe that you become who you want other people to think you are. You know, I led three different lives, three or four different lives. And we all wear masks in life. The person that you think you're talking to is usually not the person that is inside that person.
How can you tell the difference? Because I experienced that all the time, especially when I was in Hollywood working with California and all the plastic people, you just see all the phonies from A to Z. How do you distinguish that? What should our viewers look for?
I don't think you really can. If the person is really good at what they're doing how they're living their life, I don't think you can actually see the real person. You know, when we talk about depression and people that actually commit suicide, people say, well, I didn't think he would ever do it or she would ever do it. Well, none of us know what the other person is really thinking. We can't go inside another person's mind and really know what they are thinking about or what they really want to do. We become very good actors. Back in those days, I was really good at what I was doing because I was a very good actor.
So how did you feel when you have to live with yourself, okay? And so sometimes in life, people will do so many things they think they're getting away with, but they have to look at themselves in the mirror. Mm-hmm. And you're saying when you're looking at yourself in the mirror, you know you've done wrong. Mm-hmm. You see two people.
Mm-hmm. The turning point, I do, yeah. The turning point of the book is when we as a group of police officers set up a person to shoot. And we played judge and jury. And when that was over with, I realized that this was not the group that I wanted to be a part of anymore.
So one part you said in this book, it says, which I find is very interesting, and a lot of people have their own agendas in life, particularly political people, either, you know. But it says, when you make a conscious decision to take a life, you lose part of your soul. Mm-hmm. When you decide to play judge and jury to the extent that a man dies, or a woman, mm-hmm. no matter what he has done in the past, you have crossed even the imaginary line that separates right from wrong, moral from immoral, and ethical from unethical. And here again, how many people, particularly with abortion, okay, where they decide to take a life, how many of those people have lost part of their soul? They may want to camouflage it and say it's okay, right. but they have to live with that.
They have to live with it, yes. Yeah, you can never, you know, when you get to the point where you decide that you're God, you're playing God, then you've gone really over the line. You know, it's not about the law anymore. It's about your own personal.
And people get, see, Michael, people get offended when you start talking about things like that. You know, you went through a situation when you wanted to kill yourself mm-hmm. because you weren't happy. In fact, you were praying for someone to shoot you, mm-hmm. okay? But something happened. So let's go back to that day when you were on the bed, okay, mm-hmm. and you were drinking, mm-hmm. and you had the gun. Mm-hmm. Take us to that day.
That's how the book begins,
yes.
because, you know, I'm in seminary, and when people are in seminary, you think they're religious, I guess, you know, or they're in seminary because they have this calling. I have no idea why I went to seminary. I really don't. It was a commitment that I made to God when I was going through morphine trips from an accident when I was drunk. And I made a commitment to God that if I could walk again, I would go into seminary. Of course, I was Roman Catholic. So the book opens with, I'm in my last semester of seminary at Lancaster Theological Seminary. And the setting is, I'm holding a gun to my head, actually my police gun, drinking brandy, because the demon, I had, every day in seminary, actually, I was drunk. In seminary, I was going through a gallon of brandy and a case of beer every 2 days in seminary, and I could care less about life. I didn't care about the seminary. I wasn't religious. And I'm in this dorm room, and the demons are coming out, the ghosts of all the people that I have hurt in life. As a cop, all the people I set up, all the people that died doing because of what we were doing, they were coming out at me, you know. And still to this day they do. I haven't had a drink since February 21st of '89, but it was just at that moment in time where they were coming out of the mirror. And when you look at yourself in a mirror, you can see a very dark side of you that is very ugly at times because you can see the ugliness of your life. And the ghosts began to haunt me, and I couldn't live with myself, and I wanted to die. And I kept on holding the gun to one at my head, and yeah, I'm in seminary, and holding the gun to my head, drinking brandy, and eventually I just fell asleep. You know, God saved me on that day, but
then what happened that changed your life?
After that was in January of '89. In February of '89, seminary gave me an intervention, and they said because of my alcoholism, they gave me a choice: I either go to Marworth for treatment or I leave seminary. This was a couple weeks after the beginning of the book. I went to Marworth, never drank again. Never had a drink since my birthday is February 21st. Never drank again.
Folks, I'm talking to Michael Kaminski. The book is fascinating, folks. It really is. You can get this on Amazon.com, correct?
Yes.
It's Life After Russian Roulette, Game Over. It's based on a true story. It's fascinating. It really is. But it tells you how many people have thoughts of depression and suicide and how valuable life really is. Here's a man that went through hell, literally went through hell. We come back, what happens? He found a love in his life and things change. Stay with us. Wow. Thanks for staying with us, folks. I'm Sam Lesante. You're watching The Sam Lesante Show. Remember, 24/7, sspTV.com. Every one of our Sam Lesante shows are on. The person I'm interviewing is Michael B. Kaminski, a former police man and also worked undercover, is now a minister. And it's an interesting book. It's called Life After Russian Roulette, Game Over. So, Michael, you went and got straightened out. Then you met a person that mm-hmm. changed your entire life. Mm-hmm. Tell me about Sharon.
In 1998, December 13th of 1998, I physically met the woman that I was probably... she changed my life. Met her through the personals back in the days before computers, and we met on Friday, December 13th of 98, Sharon Fisher Bassett. And the thing about Sharon was I fell in love with her the first night. In fact, she was the woman that, if you read the book, she was the woman that I knew back in the 1700s.
When you were going through the morphine trips.
Morphine trips. Sharon told me she was dying from the first night that I met her.
So you met her the first night and she says she's dying.
Right. Yes. Her first marriage had been a nightmare, a very abusive nightmare. She became very anorexic during that marriage. At one point she weighed 55 pounds and had a massive heart attack in 85. She survived. God kept her alive with about 13% of her heart functioning in 85. When I met Sharon, her heart was functioning about 30%. But she told me on that first night, she said, I'm dying. She said, if you want anything physical from me, go find somebody else because I will never do anything with you sexually. I said, okay. And we stayed together for 6.5 years.
So 6.5 years, mm-hmm. You love this person, and you never saw this person naked. You never had any sexual intercourse with her at all.
Never saw Sharon without clothes off. Never saw her body.
But yet the love was so strong there. So, what was it?
I don't know. I really don't know. She taught me how to love in a way that transcends the physical. There was nothing. She couldn't say, "I love you." Sharon could not say, I love you. I felt she loved me, but she couldn't say, I do not know why I love Sharon. Except
do you believe in God?
Of course.
For those people that realize that, God doesn't exist or, somebody out there, okay, how strong should a person's faith be? Because you lived through hell. You've done things in your life that you probably regret, and it'll haunt you forever. But however, you have to have some. What do you want to tell our people out there as far as their faith is concerned, and forgetting about Catholic, Protestant, or whatever the case may be?
Without faith, I could not have lived. I really could not have lived. Back in the early days when I was doing this, and I prayed to God to get me out of this situation with the police department, and without a strong faith, I would have never made it.
So you have a favorite saint, Saint Rose.
That was the church that I was grew up with.
I like the name Rose. My mother's name is Rose.
Oh, thank you.
Okay,
thank you.
Michael, this we could spend 2-3 hours just discussing this book. All I could tell you, folks, is it's an interesting story. If you're depressed and you have some concerns in life, if you think you have it tough, when you read this book, this man was to literally hell, and he wrote a book that was, it's interesting, Life After Russian Roulette, Game Over. All I could tell you is, Michael, I always pray for people in the police department because they have a difficult life. They really do, particularly these lives, in today's life. I pray for them. And for those people that have gone astray, we hope and pray that they get back on the right path. It's an interesting book, folks. Thanks for coming on the show.
Thank you, Sam. Thank you.
His name is Michael Kaminski, folks. The book, Life After Russian Roulette, Game Over. All I can tell you, it's a must read. Thanks for joining us on The Sam Lesante Show. We'll see you next time.